I bought a HoloLens 2, and it's one of the strangest devices Microsoft have ever made. I spent weeks testing it, playing games, becoming a developer, and figuring out how exactly it works. The first HoloLens was a failure. It never turned into the future of computing we were promised. So Microsoft put it back in the oven for 3 years, and then...
I'm extremely proud to introduce to all of you HoloLens 2.
They took on a lot of feedback and made some huge improvements.
We more than doubled our field of view. We more than tripled the comfort of the device.
We spent years exploring and refining interactions for HoloLens 2. HoloLens 2 has eye tracking, fully articulated hand tracking. I can just grab this corner to resize it, or I can rotate it, or move it.
These are some big changes, and for $3,000, you could find out if they paid off, or in my case, $580 a few years later secondhand. The packaging all looks really premium. I wish more headsets came in a case like this. We've got the headset, the charger, a microfiber cloth, and the instruction manual. But most importantly, the headset, which has a sleeker and more organized design. The screen now flips up. It looks like a Quest Pro, or I suppose the Quest Pro looks like this. Bought it secondhand, but it's completely spotless. The volume and brightness buttons are on each side, the power button and USB-C is on the back, as well as the adjustment slider, which is buttery smooth. On the other side, we've got the brightness buttons. I'm happy to see a top strap added as well. I can't wait to test out that new FOV. It was my biggest complaint in the HoloLens 1. They even made the case bigger. As you may have noticed, they've moved the computing power to the back, and as a result, the distribution of weight is already feeling better. Which design do you guys prefer? Let's jump in.
Okay, so I just went through the setup and it was much easier than the HoloLens one. I just typed in my email and then there was a little bird flying around and it was pretty cool. It was a lot faster and more streamlined than the HoloLens one. To bring up the menu, you just have to tap on your palm and it comes up just like that. You can see it's a bit more colored and a bit more 3D. There's 10 pre-installed apps. They're pretty much the same as Windows 10. You've got the feedback hub, we have Edge, Store, Tips, 3D Viewer, Photos, all the apps we've come to know. It's pretty much just the same as Windows. It's very easy to adjust. It's got this dial at the back, so you can adjust it perfectly to your face shape, and you can also move this up when you want to be in the real world. This seems like a bizarre design choice, but... And the computing unit is now in the back, and it feels a lot better. It's much lighter and well distributed across your face. It's noticeably lighter than the HoloLens 1. I can see that the brightness and level of clarity is much higher. And I can just turn the volume all the way down. And then on my left, I have this brightness dial. And the headset gets ridiculously bright.
This results in a huge improvement when you're using it outside. It doesn't really come across in the camera, but you can still see the holograms. They're about 40 or 50% opacity. Compared to the HoloLens 1, which was pretty much unusable, this one you could just use. I went to an area under the shade, and it seemed completely usable.
One of the new features is you can now just touch things. If we want to navigate to the settings, we just open up the settings. And it's the same as Windows 10, as we've all come to know. You can actually grab things, and that's one of the big changes in the HoloLens 2. You can even make them bigger and smaller just by pinching them. And another advantage of that is a whole keyboard comes up, and you can use both your hands to type on it. And we have our keyboard. We can pretty much put it wherever we want. So the good news is the Microsoft Store actually works on the HoloLens 2, so I can download apps freely, which is much better than that initial headset. Downloading apps is such a pain. It's so laggy and it just takes a long time to navigate the UI. This first app we're going to try is called the Galaxy Explorer.
Let's start your journey by pinning the Earth in the center of your room. This is our home, but we are a small part of a bigger picture, which is a small part of an even bigger picture.
This feels like you're in Star Wars. It's very cool. And with that improved FOV, it's much better. And we can zoom, wow. It just makes you want to get up and move around the room and touch it. That is just so cool. I can see for education, it really visualizes what you want to look at. Only problem is, it doesn't superimpose your hands, and all I want to do is just reach out and touch these things. But it just doesn't really work like that. It's such a shame, you know? That's the next thing it needs, but maybe that would have been in the next HoloLens. We were very familiar with this in the HoloLens 1. We can put these 3D models around our room, and it does look a lot better on this new display. It's sort of what we've come to know and expect. I found this graffiti app you can use, and you just pinch and you can draw in the 3D world. And it's not the best at first, but It seems to be doing okay. You just have to be conscious of that. We could create these 3D artworks in your own room. Oh, we've got neon as well. And then we can also put on the grab function. So we can move them around. As you can see, you can just draw around your whole room. So it loses my finger when I go around the back of this. It just doesn't really superimpose, which breaks that illusion. But you could just create this whole world of holograms in your own reality. There's a much larger area for pinching. On the HoloLens 1, you kind of had to pinch up here, whereas on this one, you can move your hand all the way down and it still tracks your hand, which is a massive improvement. It feels a lot snappier and easier to use. I'm experiencing a bit of eye discomfort, so I'm just gonna run the eye calibration. Which doesn't seem to wanna work. Oop, there we go.
Your HoloLens is calibrated.
It has iris scanning, so to get into the headset, it can just use your iris rather than using a password, which is obviously a lot faster. It's a lot more secure, but I don't think this would ever leave my apartment, so I don't think anyone would ever steal it. So the eye tracking also brings foveated rendering, and apparently you can somehow navigate the UI with it, but we'll test that out a bit later.
You can see the infrared trackers and the little cameras that track your eyes.
We have this services app as well. Some of these, you just gotta get up and interact with them. Oh wow, look, the goop stuck to my hand. Yee. The field of view is much bigger than the HoloLens 1. I can definitely notice that. It feels a lot more in the room. I can definitely notice some distortion and color fringing when looking at objects. I'm not sure what exactly is causing that, but it seems a lot more pronounced than on the HoloLens 1. There's like this rainbow effect on the lenses. I can really notice that chromatic aberration and the colors around objects and through the lenses, but it's not so bad that it'll take you out of the experience, but I do definitely notice it. The materials feel a lot more premium than the older version. It feels much more well made and more of a solid product. It definitely feels like a generational leap in terms of comfort and using the headset. Okay, now we have the Mixed Reality Toolkit Example Hub, which is quite cool. It's got an example of all the different types of apps we can build using Microsoft's APK. And then this is the examples, I suppose, of what we can do with our hands. So we can turn on the hand mesh, and this seems to try and superimpose a mesh over our hand. I think that's what it's trying to do. We can also add joints to our hands, which adds that cool effect. We can also add a hand ray so we can point at things. We don't really want that though. We can turn it all off for now. We can look at some of the hand interaction examples. So this is all from the toolkit they give you, and you can just grab things, changes the color. Wonder how the physics are. That wouldn't be very good, would it? This looks like such a Unity app. You can launch external apps, it seems. In here, we have an example of the eye tracking navigation. So if I look in the bottom left, zoom in. Zoom in. Zoom in. So it basically zoomed into the exact position I was looking at. And when I look in the corners, it moves around. It does seem a bit finicky, doesn't it? Rotate. Rotate. So depending on where I look, it rotates the objects. Come to me. Pretty interesting. These are all the shader examples that they include. Some of them are so beautiful. I'm sure a lot of people at Microsoft really put a lot of work into this. It's much more fleshed out, it seems, than the HoloLens one. I couldn't seem to access any of this stuff on that headset. Based on where I look, it shows you the heat map. They didn't really use eye tracking on this headset like they should have, but I don't think they integrated eye tracking for many apps.
I tried this other Shark demo, but it didn't go too well.
They generally all just seem like these tech demos. I don't think there's any very detailed experiences. They're all basic tech demos, probably made by one or two people. Look, it's a big improvement on the HoloLens one, but the technology is just not where it needs to be. It's so cool. It's just, it's got problems. I couldn't imagine wanting to use this every day. It's sort of like a cool tech demo to try out.
Every time you open an app, you have to give it permission to use the cameras and microphones. To be honest, it's just a bit annoying. Obviously the app is going to use them. It's just so Windows. Most HoloLens apps are small tech demos built with little to no budget by one or two developers. There is, however, an exception, with three games created by Asobo Studio and Microsoft, each developed with a roughly 8-person team over a 3-month period. The Asobo Studio games are Young Conquer and Fragments, which we already played on the HoloLens one. However, there was another one, called Robo Raid, made entirely in-house at Microsoft. They eventually ported all three games to the HoloLens 2, and these are just by far the best experiences you can get on the headset. And let's take a look at Robo Raid. In Robo Raid, you use the face tracking and hand gesture pinching to fire at robots that burst through the walls. It really makes it feel like your room is under attack. It's a great example of real augmented reality. It just makes you want to bob around and look around your room. And the special part of it is you're not looking through a display, you can actually see the real world through glass. Well, cool, this would probably be done better on a Quest. While it was fun to play, I couldn't imagine playing for more than 15 minutes or ever returning to it again. Oddly, they're not well advertised. There's no central best of game page on the Microsoft Store. It's just a scattered recommendation of these apps that aren't very good. One of the most hyped games was Minecraft, but it literally never came out. They ended up turning into a mobile game and turned all the servers off in 2021. Classic. I think we've experienced most of the apps this headset has to offer, so now it's time to start developing for it.
Okay, so one of the first things we have to do to get that developer hub is enable, if it'll load. It's very laggy, it keeps freezing, it's quite frustrating. Okay, there's been a Windows update, that's great. Sure, it makes absolutely no difference. Okay, so let's go to the developer section. The longer I use it, the more I really notice this lag. And you just have to pair your device to the device portal by clicking the pair button, and then I'll see you on the computer.
So the same as the HoloLens one, you just put your device's IP address into your web browser, and then you set up a password and can connect to the developer hub. You can see a live view of the tracking, as well as see your room in 3D space. Again, it's just the same as the HoloLens one, we've seen all this before. Just having a look through the settings, there's nothing really new here. One thing I wanted to do was turn on research mode so I could access the raw camera feed of the headset. Running this, we were able to see a calibration visualization of the headset. This shows how the HoloLens 2 sensors line up with each other. This is a sensor visualization, which lets us access the raw camera feed. It's very interesting looking at these sorts of things. I was curious to see if I could get it to work in a dark room, but I just wasn't able to. Using a few tutorials and documentation, I was able to download the version of Unity required and then create a project. After changing a few settings, I installed the Windows Mixed Reality Toolkit installer and added it to my Unity project. Then I changed a few more settings, which added a few components for me to use in my scene. I added a cube and added a few assets I could move around. I used some of the tools provided and I was able to create this blue dot that will guide me to the utility gun if I'm not looking at it. It took a few tries, but I was able to remotely deploy the app to my headset. To me, it's just so cool being able to do this. 1 minute ago they were on my computer and now I'm able to visualize them in augmented reality. And as you can see, the blue dot guides me to the utility gun if I'm ever not looking at it. One of the coolest things about this is this mesh view that gets created around the world. I tried to use this in a dark room, but again, it wouldn't work. I wish there were sensors on the headset that made it work at night so you could see this mesh render 3D view of the world at nighttime. I think that would be so cool and it would just make for such a cool night vision headset. I wonder if we'll ever get a Bone Lab AR game. The utility gun's grabbable, so maybe this is the first one. It seems very good at tracking both of your hands. Even when you bring them together, it didn't seem to have any problems. I've been thinking a lot about some cool things you could probably develop for the HoloLens 2. I'd love to get a range of sensors and create some kind of multimodal vision. Creating a highly detailed 3D mesh of the world in real time in pitch black darkness. Maybe there's a way you could use sensors as well to see through walls. And imagine if you could use it to see underwater with some kind of sonar camera. You could create a live 3D map of the seabed you'd be able to see from your boat. I don't even know if these things are possible, but that's what I would like to see. There wasn't just one version of the HoloLens. Microsoft won a $22 billion contract with the US Army. The aim was to adapt the HoloLens 2 into a system called IVAS, an integrated visual augmented system. It was built on the same hardware as the HoloLens 2, but more rugged and for combat. It added night vision, thermal imaging, and weapon targeting overlays. It's rumored to even have a field of view of up to 80 degrees, which is just crazy. It was just a HoloLens 2 on steroids. Soldiers using the headset said it was just terrible. It was plagued by software crashes. Soldiers also reported getting headaches and eye discomfort just from using it. Microsoft did aim to address some of these issues, but the headset was actually getting worse after each update. It had big issues in low light environments and wasn't good in combat stress scenarios. They kept trying to fix the issues, but the contract ended up getting scaled back. It was a bit of a failure. Using the HoloLens 2 outside or in any combat scenario just seems like it would be an absolute disaster. It's slow, it crashes, and it just doesn't work properly. The potential for AR in a military setting is just absolutely huge. I could imagine some kind of Call of Duty HUD being incredibly impactful, but Microsoft just didn't seem to have the capability to build that. Palmolucky's company Anduril ended up taking over the project. There was also other versions of the HoloLens 2, including an industrial version to be used in clean room environments, as well as one bundled with some remote assist software software, and finally a hard hat version. None saw any success whatsoever. Like me, you're probably curious to know, how does the HoloLens 2 actually work? Let's hear it from Alex Kipman.
The technology behind it is called MEMS. Three lasers, red, green, and blue. One hits a fast scanning mirror at 12,000 times per second, and then hits it another one at 120 times per second. You know, here's the actual photo. The previous one was just a rendition. This is the actual thing. Now, this is under a microscope, right? If you actually were to see this mirror, they're teeny tiny. This is actually our functioning, you know, fast scanning mirror. Clearly, if you try to take a picture under a microscope at 12,000 times per second, you don't get to see a modulate like this.
The first HoloLens worked more like a projector, with a small display being projected onto the glass. The 2, however, uses three red, green, and blue lasers, which shoot on a rotating mirror and get caught by the lenses on the headset. It happens so fast, it forms an entire display, just like a laser TV. I filmed it in slow motion, and I think you can slightly see the lines being formed on the display. There was some drama around the MEMS technology, as Microsoft had claimed they invented it.
So let me break apart the display engines. This thing that we invented with HoloLens 2. The technology behind it is called MEMS world. You can't go out somewhere and say, hey, can I have some 2K displays that are like sugar cubes that, you know, pull almost no wattage to be able to ultimately display these holograms. So like we do at Microsoft when we know we can't find things out of the shelf, we've invented it.
However, someone tore one down, and the technology was actually created by a company called Microvision, and Microsoft had just licensed it. Microvision is a public company, so the investors and some tech enthusiasts were quite upset. There's a lot of posts on Reddit and website articles about it. If I was to be generous to Kipman, he may have misspoke and meant the integration into a consumer-grade product was invented by them, but the technology did previously exist.
MEMS mirrors as a technology have existed for a while. There's no new big invention on that topic. To be able to ship it in a product at this scale, at this size, at this resonant frequency is something that has not existed on Earth before.
A time-of-flight depth camera maps your surroundings in real time, creating a 3D model of the world. It's also responsible for tracking your hand movements.
So it looks like this once you actually take it out. That's the thing that measures the photons. But then we have two little doohickeys over there. Why are there two and why are there different, you know, looking things to them? It's because one of them is pointing down. Right? We call it our short throw sensor. This is the thing that illuminates your hands and lets you do precise hand tracking. High frame rate, high precision, and all the light position to where I can see your hands. The other one points forward. Slower frame rate sensor. It's our long throw sensor, and it essentially allows you to do things like spatial mapping or spatial understanding, and is really focused at understanding the environment around us.
The four cameras provide inside-out tracking. It maps walls and objects to anchor the holograms in your room. There's also an RGB camera in the middle for recording and screenshotting the world. On the inside of the headset, there's two eye-tracking cameras, and around the lenses are these infrared lights so the cameras can always see. On the back, there's an ARM-based Qualcomm Snapdragon 850. It handles apps, the operating system, and the networking. There's also a custom-made holographic processing unit. This does AI, sensor fusion, and real-time mapping.
All of that goes through our HPU, or holographic processing unit. This is custom silicon, first of its kind and best of its kind now, that runs AI inferencing on the edge. We run all of our sensor data through it and all of our AI to it.
There's also a battery which lasts 2 to 3 hours and a cooling system. It had 4 gigabytes of RAM with 64 gigabytes of storage. It also has Wi-Fi and Bluetooth. It was an excellent decision to put this on the back. It moves the center of gravity to the middle. There were lots of rumors and reports after the 2 that there was going to be a HoloLens 3, and Microsoft was working on it internally. They even filed a patent for a more modular design. There was also rumors of a partnership with Samsung, where Microsoft would make the software and Samsung would make the hardware. In October 2024, Microsoft officially ended production of the HoloLens 2, with no successor confirmed. To me, the HoloLens was just a product of its time. It represents a decade of failure for Microsoft. The fact that they were able to even build this is just incredible. It's a marvel of modern engineering. Even the manufacturing complications they would have had building the displays is hard to imagine. In 2022, the head of the mixed reality team, Alex Kipman, resigned from Microsoft, and some allegations about him went public, including workplace misconduct and creating a toxic environment. Since then, he's completely disappeared from the spotlight. The technology is cool for 5 minutes, but it's just fundamentally broken. It just doesn't work the way it should. And while they improved from the HoloLens 1 to 2, it just doesn't fix the actual problems with the headset. There isn't really a single thing you can do on this headset that wouldn't be better utilized with another technology. But to me, it's a cool collector's item and represents a unique part of history. Let me know what you thought of the HoloLens 2. I read almost every comment. As always, thanks for watching.